Everyone. Good morning. And good morning to our congregations in Alford and Rhynie as well. I'm sorry for the delay starting the service, but we had a wee bit of a technical issue. We could hear everything here, but apparently you couldn't hear us there. So anyway, it's lovely to be back amongst you. A warm welcome to any visitors that we have with us today, and also to our friends watching the service online or catching up with the recording later. Now, there will be refreshments served in each of the church after our service, so I do hope that many of you will be able to stay behind for that. So, how have you all been? Helen and I have been over to the tiny island of Colonsay, just south of Mull, in the Southern Hebrides. We had a windy time over there, but we're delighted to have Jessica join us this time, who really kept us on our toes, Helen, didn't she? It was wonderful. So I led the congregation in service last Sunday for their harvest Thanksgiving service, and we shared Holy Communion together. So many thanks to the Reverend Ricky Reed, who led worship in Rhynie Church last Sunday. Now, members of the Kirk session at their meeting on the 9th of October would have been introduced to our new interim moderator, the Reverend Sheila Mitchell, and also her colleague in Benachie Parish, the Reverend Ewan Glenn from Moneymusk. They have prepared a short video of by way of introduction, which was going to be played in our service this morning, but I'm afraid with these technical issues, we'll have to do it. So hopefully we'll be able to get it all working for next week. Now, whereas during the month of September we focused on creation and the natural world, the month of October, as well as harvest, is traditionally a month with a particular focus on tackling poverty. In the week between the 7th and the 13th of October, many churches linked in with the Challenge Poverty Week, an annual event organised by the Poverty Alliance, who engage with voluntary organisations, policymakers and politicians during the week. Now, since the early 1990s, the Church of Scotland has placed a priority on putting resources into the most deprived communities. And the Church of Scotland Faith Nurture Forum writes, "During this month, we're asking every congregation in the country to look at poverty in their own community. Every parish will contain people who are in poverty, even if some of it is hidden. And I would suggest most of it is actually hidden. The main areas are to increase awareness of the reality of poverty in Scotland, to encourage engagement in positive debate and discussion about poverty, to highlight what is currently being done to tackle the poverty issue and identify solutions." Now, Thursday, the 17th of October, was the annual International Day for the Eradication of Poverty. And the observance of this particular day can be traced back to 1987. And since then, people of all backgrounds, beliefs and social origins have gathered every year to renew their commitment. The organising committee write, "October the 17th presents an opportunity to acknowledge the effort and struggle of people living in poverty, a chance for them to make their concerns heard, and a moment to recognise the poor people are the first ones to fight against poverty." So we'll be looking at some of the themes of that in our service today. Now, our call to worship this morning, I've based it on a passage from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. And it's based on Isaiah 58, verses 6 to 11. And again, as normal, I will say the bits in italics. Please join in with the passages in bold. "Our caring Father God charges us to share our food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, the naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from our own flesh and blood. Then our light will break forth like the dawn, and our healing will quickly appear. Then our righteousness will go on before us, and the glory of the Lord will be our rear guard. If we spend ourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, Then our light will rise in the darkness, and our night will become like the noonday. Now, our first hymn, which is much used by the Christian Aid organisation, is written by Catherine Galloway and is all about hope growing from poverty, when out of poverty is born. So if you're following this in the hymn book, it's number 291. So let us stand and sing together, When Out of Poverty is Born. Thank you, Kathleen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 113. And again, we'll use it as a responsive reading. I will say the bits in italics. Please join in with the passages in bold. Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. That the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth, raises the poor from the dust, and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes, with the princes of his people. He settles the childless woman in her home as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord. Let the Lord's name be praised. Amen. Now, Psalm 113 is the first of the Hallel Psalms. Now, these are psalms of high praise, which were sung at important Jewish festivals. The psalmist is writing about the scope of God's care. His great mercy is demonstrated by his concern for the poor and the oppressed. The Almighty Creator is concerned with each one of us, and he raises those up who are struggling. Now, the Old Testament prophet Samuel is widely acknowledged to be one of the most influential of all of the Old Testament prophets. His mother, Hannah, was the wife of Elkanah, but she struggled with her sense of self-worth because she was unable to have children. It's suggested that Elkanah took Peninnah as a second wife because Hannah couldn't have any children. So you can imagine, this made her feel very worthless. And she prayed earnestly to God. In her prayer, she asked God for a son. And in return, she vowed to give that son back to God for the service of God. She promised that he would remain a Nazarite all the days of his life. So consequently, when Samuel was born, he was dedicated to God's service by his mother Hannah, and he became one of Israel's greatest prophets. He was a man of prayer who finished the work of the judges, began the school of the prophets, and anointed Israel's first kings. In the book of Samuel, the first book of Samuel, chapter 2, begins with Hannah's prayer of thanksgiving to God for giving her a son. Now, one commentary suggests that Hannah's prayer is one of the most elevated praise poems in the whole of the Bible. She prays God's uniqueness, his justice, his power, and his sovereignty. Hannah had seen God's dealings with the weak and the hungry and the barren, and prayed for God's kingdom to be established here on earth. 1 Samuel 2, verse 8. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and has them inherit a throne of honor. And that phrase again is familiar to us that we've just read in Psalm 113. And this month, as we focus on the eradication of poverty, then it fits in perfectly well with the theme of our service. I'm now going to invite Margaret to lead us in our prayers of approach and confession from Rhynie.
Let us turn to God in prayer. Almighty God, our Father, we gather as your people to worship you this morning. We remember that you, the God whom we worship, are from everlasting to everlasting, the only God, the creator of all things, the giver and sustainer of all life. You alone are worthy of our worship, our praise, and our obedience. We gather to worship you because you commanded us to love you with all our hearts and souls and mind and strength. You commanded us to remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy, a day set apart from our daily chores, a day to fix our minds on you. You commanded us not to neglect to gather often, to hear your word, to pray, to sing psalms and hymns, and to fellowship together as your family, your body. In the past, when the Israelites gathered to worship, they could only meet with you after shedding the blood of bulls and rams to atone for their sin. But we can come into your presence because Christ shed his blood as the once and for all sacrifice to atone for all our sin. In the past, only the high priest could enter the Holy of Holies, but now we do not need a priest to stand between us and you, our Father, because we have Christ as our great high priest to mediate for us. We praise and thank you for your amazing grace and mercy, that you sent your beloved Son to be the perfect sacrifice, to take our punishment on his sinless body, and to reconcile us to you, our Creator God. Because of the finished work of Christ, we, your people, can come into your presence boldly, knowing that the sins of the truly repentant are forgiven and the debt is paid. But still, we come before you with reverence and respect, with humility, and remembering that you are holy and pure, and we are not. But the righteousness of Christ is credited to us, so that we who have put our faith in him stand before you, clothed in his perfect righteousness. Father God, when we consider the works of your hands, the earth, the sun, the moon, the stars, and every creature on our planet, we are in awe of your power in creation. Our finite minds can only grasp a fraction of your glory, your majesty, your holiness. You are so high above us. Your thoughts are not our thoughts, your ways are not our ways, and yet you condescend to have communion with us, your lowly creatures. You desire that we come to you and enjoy a relationship with you. It is beyond our understanding that even though we rebel against you, disobey you, and neglect you, yet you are patient and continue to bless us in so many ways. Father, as we come into the light of your presence, we see the darkness of our own souls. We remember the many ways we have failed you in the last week, the things we have left unsaid and undone, and the things we should not have said or done but did nonetheless. Father, forgive us for our waywardness, our failures, our neglect of your word and prayer, our failure to love you with all of our hearts, our failure to be different from the world, our failure to be salt and light in a world full of corruption and decay. Father, we cling to your promise that you will never turn away the broken and contrite in spirit. We cling to your promise that a bruised reed you will not break, and a smoking flax you will not snuff out. You have promised to bless the poor in spirit and those who mourn over their sin. Only through faith in your Son can we find forgiveness, cleansing, and true peace. Forgive us that our faith is often weak, that we fail to put all our trust in you. Help us in our weakness. Father, help us to live in this broken world, understanding the promise that when Christ returns in triumph, there will be no more sin or corruption or poverty or injustice. There will be a new heaven and a new earth, and your people will be in your presence forever. Our only hope in life and death is Christ alone. Hear us now as we pray together the words that Jesus gave his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And now we're going to, I'm going to invite Ron to read from us, for us from Alford. Thank you, Ron.
Morning, all. Our second reading this morning is taken from Job, chapter 23, and I'll read the first 12 verses, and this is from the New Living Translation. Then Job spoke again. My complaint today is still a bitter one, but I will try hard not to groan aloud. If only I knew where to find God, I would go to his court. I would lay out my case and present my arguments. Then I would listen to his reply and understand what he says to me. Would he use his great power to argue with me? No, he would give me a fair hearing. Honest people can reason with him, so I would be forever acquitted by my judge. I go to the east, but he's not there. I go to the west, but I cannot find him. I do not see him in the north, for he is hidden. I look to the south, but he is concealed. But he knows where I am going, and when he tests me, I will come out as pure as gold. For I have stayed in God's paths. I have followed his ways and not turned aside. I have not departed from his commands, but have treasured his words more than daily food. And then again, turning to the Gospels, for our third reading, we turn to the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 10, and we read from verse 17 through to verse 31. And again, it's from the New Living Translation. As Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asks. "Only God is truly good. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. You must not cheat anyone. And honour your father and your mother." "Teacher," the man replied, "I've obeyed all these commands since I was young." Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. "There is still one thing that you haven't done," he told him. "Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and then you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked round and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." This amazed them. But Jesus said again, "Dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom of God. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were astounded. "Then who in the world can be saved?" they asked. Jesus looked at them intently and said, "Humanly speaking, it is impossible. But not with God. Everything is possible with God." Then Peter began to speak up. "We have given up everything to follow you," he said. "Yes," Jesus replied, "and I assure you that everyone who has given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or property for my sake and for God's news will receive now in return 100 times as many houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and property, along with persecution. And in the world to come, that person will have eternal life. But many who are the greatest now will be the least important then, and those who seem least important now will be the greatest then." Amen. Blessed to us the readings from our Lord's holy book.
It probably hasn't escaped your... I know we're having possibly sound issues today, but I'm hoping from Alford and Rhynie that you can get a good appreciation of what I got. Maybe this one is a wee bitty out the way here. Now, the day before Helen and I went over to Colonsay, I went into Strathdon School for their harvest assembly. And I was introduced to these two characters. And I did say to them, it was the children's wish that, it'd be nice if you could take them into the church. So they are in the church. They're a wee bitty scary looking things, I think. Now, just to give you a little bit of explanation, this one here is a chimney sweep. The children at Strathdon have been learning all about Victorians. And one of the things that they learnt about was the fact that in Victorian times, young children could be sent up the chimney with a brush to sweep and clean the chimney. So this is what this particular character is. And you can just about see here, there is the chimney brush that they're going up and sweeping everything around. So that's fine. Now, when I introduce the next one to you, you might be a wee bit shocked, I'm afraid. It looks like something out of a lost world or something like that. But this, and again, because of our friends online, I shall move her a little bit closer and hope that she'll stay there. May I proudly introduce to all of you Queen Victoria. Yes, indeed. I mean, they've taken a lot of time, as you were saying, George, to put all the black on and everything else like that. It took them a while to, to do that. So this was their work to do with harvest and thinking about how we protect our crops and the fact that scarecrows are there in the field to protect our growing crops. Well, the other thing we were talking about in the school at their harvest assembly, we're trying to think about something that had scarecrows in. And of course, there is one particularly very, very famous and much-loved film that has at least one scarecrow in it. And that, of course, is that beloved film, The Wizard of Oz. And I'm sure that many of you have seen that. I was actually quite surprised with the response from the children in Strathdon, because they seem to have, most of them seem to know everything about it. You know, who Dorothy was and Toto the dog and everything else like that, which was wonderful. I don't know whether, I know it's the middle of our school holidays, so I'm not sure if we have any children in our church in Alford. But hopefully, if you can hear me, if you know The Wizard of Oz, just nod your head and say, yeah, that's absolutely fine. Of course, along the way, Dorothy meets the Scarecrow. The Scarecrow wants a brain. He doesn't think he has a brain. She also meets the Tin Man. And the Tin Man really wants a heart, because he's made out of tin and he doesn't think he has a heart to feel things. And then, of course, the third character that she met along the way was the Cowardly Lion. And that Cowardly Lion wanted courage. Now, I think the film was, and I was telling the children it's just done, the film actually is wonderful and it's brilliant. It's a fantasy film, but it's all about self-belief. And when you think about it, The Scarecrow wanted a brain. He already had a brain. The Tin Man wanted a heart. And okay, they gave him this little red thing that he could hang around his neck, but he already had a heart. And the Cowardly Lion really wasn't cowardly after all, because he roared and roared loudly. And there are many times in our lives, of course, when we feel a little bit uncertain about things. We feel as though we're not good enough to do this or to do that. But one of the messages from the films is really believe in yourself. And that was the message that I was given to our children in Strathdon. Now, they'd also brought a lot of donations of food, which is great. And during the week before we went away, I was in Took School, I was in Terry School, I was also in Lumsden School as well as Strathdon. And in our conservatory, Helen, we have bags and bags and bags of food that we are going to donate to the food bank. Now, the Trussell Trust are the main operators of the food banks. They've got 43 right across the country. And they have seen, in this last year, a 21% increase on the usage of food banks. And, of course, with the cost of living as well, they're not getting the amount of donations that they would normally get. And the trouble is, of course, with everything going up, it's not going to get much better than that. And it's going to be a very, very cold and bleak winter for many, many people. And of course, today we're talking about poverty. But poverty is just the next step on. That is just a term. But there are many, many people who are struggling. And talking about somebody struggling, that was the reading that Ron read out to us from Job. Now, Job is probably the oldest book in the Bible, written about 2,000 years before the birth of Jesus. And Job was a very successful merchant, a bit like the rich man in the Mark reading as well. He was very successful. He had lots of land, he had lots of houses, he had lots of cows and sheep and everything else like that. He had a wonderful family that loved him, and they didn't want for anything. But he was also a devout follower of God. But if we know the story of Job, right the way through the book of Job, he went through a number of trials and tribulations to test his faith. And in the end, his world was turned upside down. He lost his family. He lost his home. He lost all of his possessions. And at one point, his whole body was covered with painful sores. But he refused to give up on God. And God refused to give up on him. Although he was still moaning about what had happened, and why he was putting through these things, he was searching for the answer. Why? Why am I being tested? It must be something that I've done in the past that's catching up with me. Now, Job had three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, who, hearing what had happened to Job, went to him to sympathize and to comfort with him. And those friends helped him through those difficult years. And sometimes we might feel alone. We might feel that the world is against us. But it's important to remember, like Job, that we don't give up on God because God won't give up on us. So Job's friends helped him through the most difficult of times. And if we have, coming into this time of year now, with, you know, the shorter days, the temperature dropping, storms hitting us and whatever it is, if we have friends or neighbors who are struggling, if you haven't heard from anybody for a while, haven't seen them, you think, I wonder how so-and-so is getting on, then we could maybe be that helping hand, that shoulder to cry on, that listening ear, and showing the love of God in action. And on our next hymn, we ask that absolute question, were you there? So we're standing and sing together from the hymn book number 544, When I Needed a Neighbor, Were You There? Now, I'm not sure if we have any children with us in Alford, as I mentioned, so I don't know whether you have some sheets or something to, because there's no Sunday school until next week. One of the things that really did impress me when I was going around one of our schools before we went on holiday, was the wide vision that they have of neighbours. And we're talking about, you know, being a neighbour. We tend to think of a neighbour being possibly somebody that lives along the street from us, or somebody lives next door, or something like that. But the children are, the way that the schools are teaching them now, they're thinking much more about global neighbours, which I think is a really comforting thing. And that's something in this month of October, when we're looking at the eradication of poverty, that's something that we should think about. Now, the Poverty Alliance has provided several resources for Challenge Poverty Week. And one of the things that they put together, they've kind of concentrated on Scotland. So having said all about global neighbours, I'm going to concentrate on Scotland. So they write that, in Scotland we believe in justice and compassion and want to see our country reflect these values. That's why we all think that ending poverty must be a top priority for all levels of government. It cannot be right that one in five people today are living with the constant pressure of trying to get by on an insufficient income. Low wages, inadequate social security payments, and the rising cost of living are holding people back. So that's really what this particular month is all about, to raise awareness and to start the debate on many of the complex issues surrounding poverty. And as far as the church is concerned, we as Christians, in this month particularly, should hold close in our prayers all those across our world, all our global neighbours who are living in poverty. And we pray for all of those who are working to alleviate the problem. Now, the Challenge Poverty Week is the annual campaign, and it gives an opportunity to raise the voice against poverty. More and more of us are being pulled towards the current of poverty by raising costs and inadequate incomes. The cost of living crisis, higher fuel bills, the price cap just going up, and many of our essential food items are costing a lot more now than they used to do. In 2023, 500 organisations from across Scotland were involved in Challenge Poverty Week. We're all joined together in a unified voice and tackling action to end the injustice of poverty. Now, poverty means not being able to make ends meet, not being able to heat your home, pay your rent, or buy essentials. It means waking up every day facing insecurity, uncertainty, and impossible decisions about money. And of course, we do have to think about those who are forced into homelessness as well. That is a huge issue, and there are many, many charities that are helping with that. On the 6th of October, in our harvest celebration, our harvest Thanksgiving service in Alford, our joint service, all the items that were collected, and again, many, many thanks for everybody that contributed to that, but all the items were sent to the Cyrenians, who are helping to eradicate homelessness and working against the issues of homelessness. According to the Scottish Government's own statistics, it's estimated that 21% of Scotland's population were living in relative poverty. 21%. That's the one in five. A person is in relative poverty, this is how they measure it, if the household income is less than 60% of the current UK average. Now, it's estimated further than that 24% of children were living in relative poverty. 24%. So what does this mean for people in reality? It means that children are going without things that they need. It means that adults are not being able to afford things they need, like household goods, clothes, or travel costs to work, or job interviews. It means social exclusion, being unable to participate in aspects of society, like school trips or social activities, because they just cannot afford it. Not being able to pay essential bills like heating or electricity. And that's why it does concern me, and it concerns a lot of people this particular year as we're moving into the winter time, that a lot of people will be struggling with their energy costs. It causes mental health problems like anxiety or depression. Going without the things that they either need or enjoy can make life difficult. Unemployment, insecure employment, low pay, and the cost of living are some of the reasons why many people are thrown into poverty. I mean, employment does not even guarantee a route out of poverty. 182,000 children in Scotland live in poverty, despite having one person in their household at work. So what can we do about it? I've already mentioned the fact that we can hold all of these people in our prayers. The World Health Organization estimate that as a result of the effects of climate change as well, shifts in temperature, rainfall, sea level, that more than 1 million people will return to extreme poverty by 2030. Which of course will have a negative impact on people's health. So can we really just sit back and do nothing about it? The rich young man in the passage from Mark's Gospel was told that what he had to do to inherit eternal life was to give away all his possessions and give the money to the poor. But he was not very best pleased about that. And you could just imagine him when Jesus said that to him, the look of displeasure on his face, walking away thinking, well, that's me finished then, because I cannot do that. But can we as Christians just walk away from poverty or people struggling? Increasing donations of food items to the food bank is a practical way to help a developing crisis. But it merely deals with the symptoms of poverty, not the causes. So as faith communities, we're encouraged to pray for all those living in relative poverty, both nationally and locally and internationally, of course. We're encouraged to speak out, maybe getting in touch with our local MP or MSP and ask what steps are being taken. We're encouraged to get involved with any local charities or initiatives aimed at alleviating poverty in our own communities. But what can we do, perhaps, as West Gordon Parish? If you remember, we were talking about a few weeks ago about how we want to be seen. How do we want to be seen by others as they come into our premises? We want to be seen as a loving, caring community. So what can we do? With the winter coming on, maybe we should consider what actions that we can take in. Definitely, we commit all of those who are dwelling in poverty to prayer. We hear in Psalm 113 how our loving Father God raises up the poor from the dust and lifts the needy up from the ash heap. So in our prayers, we should remember and pray that he will influence all those in positions of authority to work towards the eradication of poverty. And we remember and we think about all those people in our communities who are not broadcasting the fact, but we know are there. So let's be watchful, let's be caring, let's be a community who goes out and meets people and helps them and brings them into the love of God. Our next hymn is actually like a prayer, where we lay our broken world in sorrow at God's feet. So we'll stand and sing together. It's number 721 in the hymn book, We Lay Our Broken World. And George, could I ask for the offering to be brought forward, please? Thank you. Now I'm going to invite Somersel to lead us in prayer. Thank you, Somersel.
Let us pray. Lord of life, you have called us together in the name of Jesus Christ. In him and through him, we praise you. Generous God, we give thanks for the richness of life, for the beauty of this glorious autumn season, and the wonders of the world that you created. We thank you for the care of those that love us, for the strength and hope in difficulties, and for the presence with us of your Holy Spirit. You have given us so many gifts which make us what we are, the talents of mind and eye and hand, for every opportunity to be of service, for those who love and cherish us, and for neighbors and friends, we truly thank you. Gracious God, we bring our prayers for the world, for those who rebuild where things have been destroyed, for those who fight hunger and poverty and disease, for those involved in the eradication of poverty. May their efforts help us to keep in mind those suffering from rejection, shame, and humiliation because of poverty. We also pray for those who have power to bring change for the better and to renew hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country, for King Charles and Queen Camilla on their tour of Australia. Lord, give them strength and energy for each day. We pray for those who frame our laws and shape our common life, and for those who keep the peace, administer justice, for those who teach, for those who heal. Lord, we thank you. We pray for those whose life is a struggle, those whose lives are clouded by death or loss, pain or disability, by discouragement or fear, by ill health or grief. Lord, we ask for your love and presence to comfort them. We pray for those in the circle of friendship and love around us, children and parents, brothers and sisters, friends and neighbors, and for those especially in our thoughts today. We thank you that you loved us first so we can love others. We pray for our church and all the churches throughout Scotland in its state of change. Give us courage and foresight to do your will in whatever situation we find ourselves, whether it be new or old routines. May we always praise you and give you the glory. We bring our offering to you, acknowledging that all your gifts are given for growth and for service for all. Receive our offering and worship, and show us the gifts we do not know we have to offer. We ask all these prayers in the strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Lovely, thank you very much. And now, Phyllis, if you're there in Rhynie, I'm going to ask you, please, if you'll take us through the notices for today. Thank you.
The notices are on the order of service, but I'll just highlight one or two. Many thanks to everyone who organised the coffee morning in Rhynie yesterday, and to everyone who supported it. It was very well attended. Also, thanks to everyone who contributed towards the harvest hamper, and the monies will go to the church funds. The change of date for the Blythewood Care shoe box collection is now the 3rd of November, giving you a few extra days to contribute either with single items or complete shoe box. At 3 o'clock this afternoon, there is a special service of thanksgiving which will be held in Towie Church, where we are able to share some special memories of worshipping in this beloved church building. The service, which will also include the Sacrament of Holy Communion, will be followed by refreshments in the Village Hall. All are welcome. And the Tuesday morning Bible discussion group is starting a new course on Tuesday, starting at 9:30 to 11 o'clock in West Gordon, Alford, and you are invited to pop in and see what we do. The course book is entitled Life Lessons from Philippians. Further information from Somerset. Thank you.
That's great, Phyllis. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Well, many thanks for joining us this morning for worship. I do apologise to all our congregations for the slight delay at the beginning with technical issues. There are things that we are still learning about how the system works, so thank you for bearing with us. And I would like to add as well, if you are planning to come to Towie this afternoon, please be careful, because the wind and the rain and everything else may well pick up as the day progresses. So please drive safely. But you'll have a warm welcome if you're able to make it there. So that will be lovely. So thank you very much, Kathleen, for playing for us. Thank you to Ron for reading, to Somersall, Margaret and Phyllis for helping us with the service, and to Dick, Sue and Paul for dealing with all the technology and the issues that we had at the day. Thank you very much indeed for that. I do hope that you'll be able to stay behind for refreshments. In our final hymn, we bring all our thoughts and reflections together as we pray for the healing of the nations of this world. So we'll stand and sing together our final hymn, which is number 706 in the hymn book, For the Healing of the Nations. Raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and has them inherit a throne of honour. For the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. On them he has set the world. Merciful Father, as we focus on challenge poverty, help us to be your eyes, your ears, and your hands in this place, raising up the poor and needy in your name. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us and all those who we love this day and forevermore.